Welcome. Welcome to Randolph Memorial Baptist Church. We're so glad to have you today. Welcome to the church, and it is a beautiful day, and I believe this is the first day of spring, is that right? Or close about, so spring is here. It sure feels great to see that if the wind will finally die down, but it is so nice to see warmer temperatures. Got a lot going on. I'm going to try to share some of the announcements, but we have a whole lot going on. And you can make, of course, it's all on Facebook, but for those who are not on the internet or our website, want to make sure you know about them. Want to share that today, right after worship, the personnel committee will meet in the conference room, and it really won't be long. We just got a couple of updates to give you, and make sure you're on board with what we're going to do next. You're going to know what you're doing when you go in there. One, I'll give you an update on the youth director search team. We now have 5 people that will be on that team. And we're going to vote April the 3rd. So that is J.R. Swisher, Dana Jackson, Christy Cash, Mara Peters, and Joanne McClure. We will vote April the 3rd, right after worship. It's a special call meeting, so that's all we do. So we'll vote on them, commission them, and then they can begin getting organized and doing what they need to do. You'll hear a lot more about that journey as we go along, but that's what's happening. But the thing, the personnel, just so you know, so that when you make a phone call to the church, there are some changes, and I've got to talk to the personnel today about what we need to do to fill the gap. But Amanda will be leaving in 2 weeks. When she first came, she told us, I got 5 years till her husband graduates, and then he does his residency. Well, it's been 5 years. He's got his residency, and it's in South Carolina. That's a long commute. So we love Amanda. She's really sad she's got to leave us, but I'm thankful that he got a great residency program and can take that next step to being a doctor. And they're going to be leaving in a couple of weeks, and so you'll hear different voices probably on the phone, and the office won't always be open at the same times. We will advertise that as soon as we get it all played out. But personnel, I'll go over what steps we need to do next to get that desk filled at some point, hopefully soon, sooner than later. I ask you as a church, just be patient. Be flexible as we transition, but we've done it before and we will get there. Pray for both Cadence and Amanda in these transition periods. That is what's happening. And so Tuesday there is a nominating committee at 10:30, and please be there for that. Wednesday the Lent service is at Rose Chapel, and that's at noon, and so that's going to be fun. And then next Sunday we have lunch, a farewell lunch for Cadence at noon. And so bring a plate of food, bring a card. There's going to be a little basket there if you want to give her a gift, financial gift, or just a card, a greet, whatever you want to do. We call it a money tree without a tree because our tree was starting to sag, so it's a basket. But that will be there, and so that's what's happening. The music, of course, Tuesday and Wednesday, the choir and the praise band. Next Sunday night, the Fellowship of Christian Athletes of Amherst County will be in our church. We're just hosting the building. They do their music, and they do their, and it's student-led in every, in the music, student-led in the speaking, they're students. And so that's at 5:30, and anyone's welcome. If you want to come and sit back there and listen to some great music and be inspired by some of these kids, it's wonderful. I'm glad we can host them. And so it's kids from our county who are involved with the Fellowship of Christian Athletes. So that's a really cool opportunity to encourage those kids and be encouraged by them. So that's what's going on. There's a lot going on. The stewardship meeting will be not tomorrow, but the next Monday. Keep that on your calendar. As they continue to work, and that's always at 6. Susie has a couple of announcements.
Good morning. This first announcement is to our at-home audience. A lot of times when you're watching the service, whether it's actually live on Facebook Live or later on YouTube or Facebook, you'll notice that there's a little bit of a few seconds where the audio will go away. And I just wanted to take this opportunity to explain that the reason that happens is because of the Wi-Fi in the room. It is not anything that sound tech's doing. It's not anything really we can do anything about right now, except just to know that those 3 seconds are going to show up sometime during the service. We know it's happening because the light on the camera goes green, but you don't have any way of knowing that that's not something that we are doing on purpose. We are not. we are just at the mercy of the Wi-Fi in the room. The second announcement is to encourage all young people in grades 4 through grades 9 to see if you would like to participate in music and worship arts camp, which is going to be July the 11th through the 15th. It's at Eagle Eyrie, and it's a really fun time. We have maybe a few music campers in here. I don't know. I see one or two former music campers in here. But if you would like to go, I've got brochures, and I'll be happy to talk to any parents or grandparents who might be interested in sending their young person. It is a lot of singing, but it's also a lot of fun. There's recreation time. There's drama. There's photography. There's a lot of other options, guitar, a lot of other things that young people can learn, and how to use their musical talents or their other worship art talents in our worship services. So keep that in mind and let me know if you're interested. Thanks.
Thankful Susie mentioned that about our buffering. If you've ever been on Netflix or something that buffers, it's kind of what happens, and I have been asked that several times, but hopefully it won't happen too many times. We've got a lot of things going on. I want to keep them before us. Final thing I'll say, and then we'll move into worship, is in the transition time, we do have lots of opportunities to work with our youth, and we have parents stepping up. The youth program starting in April will be on Sunday nights, and so that in Sunday school, so and we'll be doing some fun activities. Contact Christy Cash, the chair of youth committee. If you have questions, you can message me as well. The sign-up lists are upstairs. But we've already got folks stepping in and stepping up, and we're thankful for that. If you think, well, I want to help, but I'm not sure what I should do, just have a conversation with me, and we'll talk about what your skills are and your interests are and things that you might be able to bring that could be creative and maybe a little different. And so we're open to that, and so that will be wonderful. We're beginning our worship service today. We're glad you're here to worship with us. This is a good day to be in God's house. Moment, and then we will praise God as we gather here on this beautiful Lord's Day.
Would you join me as we are called to worship, as stand and hear the word of the Lord from Psalm 28. Through eight. Praise be to the Lord, for he has heard my cry for mercy. The Lord is my strength and my shield. My heart trusts in him, and I am helped. My heart leaps for joy, and people, a fortress of salvation for his anointed one. Let us pray. Holy Spirit, gift of God Most High, fill us with your presence as we seek you, as we hear you, as we feel you. Use us in this moment of worship. Amen. Would you join me in the singing of hymn number 354? The words are on the screen. Praise him, praise him.
Let us pray. Gracious God, as part of our praise, we give these gifts today because we are so blessed and we hope that they will go to bless others in our world. We give thanks in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, we pray. Amen. Amen. You may be seated. Thank you.
Ukrainians are fleeing for their safety and for their lives, leaving behind their homes, their people, and their country. We see them on our screens and read their stories in the news. As Russia invaded, BJV churches like yours took action through an established network of partners already in Ukraine.
For decades, Virginia Baptists have worked all across the globe, forming partnership with other Baptist national unions and conventions. And through this forum, we're able to bring Baptists from across the globe together to respond to crises, much like what's happening in Ukraine right now.
When you give to Aid for Ukraine through BGAV, your gift goes through the European Baptist Federation, our longstanding ministry partner and the main coordinating body for this response.
Virginia Baptists were able to immediately release $20,000 that was sent to Ukraine to help those that are fleeing from this crisis. These funds were able to provide water, food, and shelter for those in Ukraine, as well as those who have left for bordering countries.
Baptists from across the globe have come together around a specific prayer and giving efforts in Ukraine, aiming to meet real needs of food, shelter, and safety. As a Virginia Baptist, you are part of something big. Working together for Christ, we make a bigger impact than when we work alone.
Thank you to all you pastors, to all the churches, for all the Sunday school classes, for all the groups that stop and have a word of prayer for those in Ukraine, and particularly for our Baptist family in Ukraine.
Thank you for your prayers and gifts for the people of Ukraine. Thank you for entrusting BGAV with those gifts. And thank you for being an important part of all we do at BGAV as your network for missions and ministry in Virginia and around the world.
As we've done all week, all year, since this has occurred, we take a moment of silence when we begin our prayer for Ukraine. We continue to pray for them and for those who are working and putting their lives at risk to do that. And then we'll pray for our local needs. So let us pray. God, we lift up these names and these prayer needs today. We give thanks for the following, God. Gracious God, we worship today. We praise you. We pray, we sing, we proclaim, knowing that there are many folks who are in situations that we can't even imagine. We're thankful for those who help, those who look for ways to make a difference. We pray that we can be a part of that in some way. We pray for the local needs and the needs around us that we see and we know. There are needs in this room that perhaps no one else knows about. There's still folks struggling from all kinds of things that we've been praying for, and we lift them up to you as well. But we have to be thankful and grateful for life, for love, for this community of faith, for all the opportunities we have to be community. We're thankful to be able to be here. We know what it's like to not be able to, and so we're grateful. We pray that you'll just continue to speak to us through this worship so that you can speak through us this week. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Spirit, we pray, and all God's people say.
Well, has purchased peace. The innocent was bound to set the captives free.
There you made a way, the lost are welcome home again. At the cross, your glory bore my shame. At the cross, you suffered in my place. You gave everything for us. At the cross, the Prince of Heaven died. At the cross, death became alive. You gave everything.
Our scripture reading will be Genesis 37, verses 1 through 11. Jacob lived in the land where his father had stayed, the land of Canaan. This is the account of Jacob's family line. Joseph, a young man of 17, was tending the flocks with his brothers, the sons of Bilhah and the sons of Zilpah, his father's wives. And he brought their father a bad report about them. Now Israel loved Joseph more than any of his other sons, because he had been born to him in his old age, and he made an ornate robe for him. When his brothers saw that their father loved him more than any of them, they hated him and could not speak a kind word to him. Joseph had a dream, and when he told it to his brothers, they hated him all the more. He said to them, "Listen to this dream I had. We were binding sheaves of grain out in the field, when suddenly my sheave rose and stood upright, while your sheaves gathered around mine and bowed to it." His brother said to him, "Do you intend to reign over us? Will you actually rule us?" And they hated him all the more because of his dream and what he had said. Then he had another dream, and he told it to his brothers. "Listen," he said, "I had another dream, and this time the sun and the moon and the 11 stars were bowing down to me." When he told his father as well as his brothers, his father rebuked him and said, "What is this dream you had? Will your mother and I and your brothers actually come and bow down to the ground before you?" His brothers were jealous of him, but his father kept the matter in mind. This is the word of God. Let's pray. God, please take these ancient words and may they speak to us and help us in some way as we try to live our lives today. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Just keep swimming. What movie has that line? Anybody know? Nemo, heard it behind me. The 2003 movie Finding Nemo. That was Dory the Fish's signature song and her mantra for keeping going and not giving up. Now, if you want, I could have sung this song to you, or I could have the choir sing it to you, but you don't want me singing it, and I haven't told the choir, so they don't want to sing it on the spot. But if you know that song, you might could win on Jeopardy, but it goes kind of like this. Hey, Mr. Grump Gills, you know what you're going to do when life gets you down? Just keep swimming. Just keep swimming. Just keep swimming, swimming, swimming. What do? We swim, swim, swim. Oh, 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 how I love to swim. When you want to swim, you want to swim. Deep theology. Silly song, but lots of wisdom. Because sometimes as hard as life gets, as unfair as it is, we have to keep going. Determination. Swimming. We can't stop. We have to keep going. And so this is our final sermon in this Genesis series where I've used movie titles. This is actually part two. I did the first part in the fall. We're wrapping it up. We're moving on to other things next week. But we come now, we land the plane to one more time, look at these stories, and we talk about Joseph, a Sunday school favorite for kids. Now, honestly, I could do multiple sermons on Joseph, and I actually have, but I'm just going to kind of sum him up today. But I present him to you as a good closing because Joseph is the guy who just couldn't stop swimming. He just kept going no matter what happened. He was determined. Now, Joseph, let's talk about him. He's the son of Jacob. Now, you notice in the scripture, Jacob now has another name he goes by. Jacob is also going by the name Israel. Now, this is going to now be the name that the nation's going to be called that's being formed. And this name came after Jacob wrestled with God. So the word Israel, the nation of Israel, the word Israel means he struggled. And Jacob did in many ways, as did all of his descendants, and as do you and me. In fact, it could actually be translated as wrestling. And later it will take on a more royal meaning, but you can't get to success without wrestling a little bit. And I guess we've all been wrestling these days. So the story we've traveled is one big wrestling match, Jacob slash Israel. His story has brought him back to where he started, where his family settled and flourished, and the children born from these four women would grow to form families of their own, and his son's Joseph story would begin. Now, you heard the text. Joseph is just 17. He's young, he's eager, he's excited about life, like most 17-year-olds. He's ready to conquer the world. And he's the son of the woman that Jacob loved, the only one of the four women he had in his life that he loved, and that was Rachel, which made him his favorite. Now, Rachel would have two children, Joseph and Benjamin, but she would die giving birth to Benjamin. And so all of these circumstances made Joseph be his favorite. And maybe it was because he really only loved Rachel, and this was his first, and while not the firstborn, he saw Joseph as such. We sit here and hear this story, and if you've been in this sermon series, you want to say, here we go again. Because what we've seen week after week is almost repetitive. They practice favoritism, deceit, and backbiting like the worst of them all. I mean, Jacob's grandfather Abraham favored Isaac over Ishmael. His mom favored Jacob over his brother Esau. And Jacob favored Rachel over the other women. And now he favors one son over the others. None of this goes well, ever. They don't seem to learn the lessons. Aren't you glad we learned the lessons of our mistakes? Sadly, humanity still struggles to get along. We see this going on even in the Ukraine and Russia. People with common ancestry, common language at times, and common relatives cross the border, and now we see this. It's tragic. So let's consider these kids and these women for a minute. These were the wives, or the maid wives, but the children, the women who gave all these children. There was Leah, the least favorite and favored, and we felt sorry for her, and we should. It was terrible. It's tragic. But she had six of the sons and one daughter and was never able to get the love from Jacob that she deserved. It's tragic. And then there's Rachel, the one he really loved. She has Joseph and Benjamin and dies giving birth to Benjamin. But then there's Bilhah, Rachel's servant, who serves as a surrogate and has two sons. And Zilpah, Leah's servant, who serves as a surrogate and has two sons. Last time you're going to hear me say it, it sounds corny joke, but I got to do it one last time because it won't fit any other sermon series. But my biggest theological point during this whole thing has been lots of kids with lots of women is lots of drama. That's what you see in Genesis. It is just chaos. And so now we come to Joseph. Daddy's favorite. The other brothers knew it, and they hated him for it. I don't know about you, which one of your siblings you thought that Mom and Dad liked best. Maybe you think that they like one best, but I guarantee it was never like this. So Jacob slash Israel gets a special coat made and gives it to Joseph. Now, I've seen the Broadway play, and I grew up in Sunday school with a coat of many colors, because that's what the King James Version has, but the translation's not quite many colors. It just means it's an ornate, fancy coat. It's just really fancy. It's over the top. Nobody else gets one. And you've heard the story. The brothers are hard at work, and here comes Joseph in his fancy coat. When I was a kid, side note, the fancy coat everybody wanted was Michael Jackson's Thriller jacket. So maybe that's what he had going on, all the zippers. But he shows up, and they don't have it. And they have a nickname for him, which you see why, but they call him the Dreamer. Now, my brother probably wanted to kill me many times, but not literally, but they literally want to murder him. They want to kill him and take the blood of and tell their dad an animal killed him. And that was their plan. Now, I've heard of problems with brothers, but this is pretty bad. The story shows us that Reuben stops it. He doesn't want him killed. Doesn't make Reuben a hero. But they do attack him, beat him up, take his clothes, throw him into a pit, don't give him water. And then Judah comes up with a great idea. Let's just sell him into slavery. Make some money off this kid. So Joseph is headed to Egypt. Now, I want to talk about this real quick. Considering the brothers of Joseph, we have to remember that this is the future tribes of Israel. Those tribes come from these mixed up boys. They're a part of the big story. They're a part of God's story. But they're willing to kill out of jealousy. So what about Joseph? He tells his brothers in dreams that they will serve him one day. He does do that. And he does create jealousy and make it worse. He wants them to know that one day he's going to be the boss. And he's telling them the truth. God is working through Joseph to do something pretty amazing, but Joseph doesn't have the sense to know that's probably not something you want to share out there in the field without Dad to protect him. Which leads me to a very deep theological point, great theological point, and here it is. Is Joseph a jerk? Is he a jerk? I mean, he comes in bragging with his coat and throwing it in their faces. Well, you got to consider where he is. And forgive me if you're a teenager, I'm not saying that you're immature, but he's 17. He's just a kid. And his dad's the one that sent him there to tattle on him and spy on him. We're not the same as we were when we were younger. We learn lessons. We make mistakes. His crime is that he's spoiled by his dad. That's not a death sentence crime. And it's not all of his fault that his dad made him a little prince. He's not a villain. It's a tattletale, but he's not a villain. But then again, when you see why Dad had him tattle, you might understand. Because let me introduce you to those brothers, just a few of them. The oldest brother is Reuben. He really should be in charge of it all. He's the oldest. And I'm going to clean this up because really when you read Genesis, you're going to go, whoa. So I'm going to try to scale it down to PG or G if I can. So I'll be very careful here. But Reuben, we learn, is intimate with one of those maidservants who his half-brother's mama. That's not good. Simon and Levi once slaughtered a whole town because their sister Dinah was victimized. And that's a tragic story. But I don't know that their motives were all that pure or that everybody they killed was involved. They acted rashly, and their dad was concerned that they'd bring a war down on them and get them all killed. And then there's Judah. You can see why I don't preach on some of these stories. Basically, Judah also had a relationship we wouldn't approve of with his daughter-in-law, and his excuse was he thought she was a lady of the evening. That doesn't make it better. These boys needed some family counseling, okay? So Dad should have been the one checking on them, not Junior. But Dad sends Junior to do it. And that puts Joseph in a tough spot. Now again, Joseph has those dreams, vivid dreams, where he can tell people what their dreams mean and see the future. And in chapter 37, we find he has his own dreams of greatness and leadership. And that, of course, is what made him mad. Okay, so no one's perfect. And as we look at this, we see that in the brokenness of humanity, God can work. Because our world is so broken today, there are no secrets hidden here. It's all laid out for us to see that humanity can be in such a mess, but even in the mess, God can work to find some meaning, and that's very hopeful. So Joseph winds up in Egypt, far from home. But remember the title of the sermon, He Keeps Swimming. What do I mean? Well, he gets a job for a wealthy man. That man's wife wants him to have an affair, which he refuses. He may be immature, but he has integrity and character. He does the right thing, which leads to an accusation, a false accusation, and a lie, which puts him in jail. But what does Joseph do? He keeps swimming. in jail. His talents help him with others. He's able to tell people their dreams, and he's honest with them, but then he winds up getting forgotten. But what does he do? He keeps swimming. He finally gets out of jail. He becomes a voice of reason. He helps the nation of Egypt make wise decisions when there's an approaching famine. He saves the Pharaoh and the people by showing them the meaning of their dreams. They come up with a plan to save everybody because Joseph keeps swimming. Well, the famine hits and his entire family comes into Egypt. They don't recognize him, but their image is burned in his brain because he sure recognizes them. And just to make it really quick, he creates an elaborate plot of revenge, but in the end, he can't do it. He can't kill them. He can't even hurt them because he's better than that. He has integrity and character. And he winds up saving his entire family, saves them all because he kept swimming. What they meant for bad, God meant for good. His entire life led to a moment of redemption. And he calls for his dad and they're reunited. All because of this determination, that promise that went to Abraham can now happen. The future God gave Abraham that his descendants would be as numerous as stars is now possible. The future that God carried Isaac to Rebekah to move the ball down the field once more. The future that Jacob came into that brought him into a blended family above all blended families. The future which was born out of, was being born. Can take whatever mess that we were thrown into or created and do something with it. So when we look at these scenes, we squirm a little bit and they don't always make sense. But here's the thing. We're focusing on this little sliver of the story, but if we could take the camera and just scale it back a little bit, we can see there's so much more at work. If we get the angle wider and we can see God is at work. And it happens when you keep swimming. Now, friends, I get it. I get it. Life gets hard. Let's land this thing to our life. Life gets hard. And all of us are in different situations. And some of our situations are not fair at all. But we're all in situations. But here's the thing. Swimming is not going to be easy. No one ever said it would be. Lava Najaka was lost with a friend last year for 29 days at sea in a little raft boat. They rescued them, and I was amused when the first thing she told the reporter was this. They asked her, you know, how she's doing, and she said, it was a nice break from everything. You know the world's been bad for the last 2 years with COVID and shutdowns and everything going on, that you'd rather be in a raft in the middle of the ocean than among other people. That's something. I sympathize. Are there days you'd like to get in a little boat and just go out into the pier and just stay away from everybody? I get that. I mean, Joseph went through obstacle after obstacle. Sometimes he created the tension, but most of the time it was thrown on him. And he made right choices, and still bad things happen. And he had every reason to get bitter. He had every reason to be angry, to give up. He could have spent his whole life in pity or bitterness, but he kept going. Why? Why do we have to do that? I mean, it is true life is unfair. People can be mean. We've all been hurt. But my friends, if we don't move forward, life will never be what it could. I would say to you today that we have no choice but to swim. What do I mean? Well, the alternative is sinking. Do you want to sink or do you want to swim? If Joseph had given up, they would not have been rescued. The famine would have killed everyone, even his family. And the promise of God would have stopped in its tracks. God does God's part, but as I've said all along, we have to do ours. Determination, faithfulness, forward, always. Okay, so I want to kind of land this by giving you some basic, really concrete tips. And I'm not a swim coach, but if I can pretend to be a swim guide, I want to give you a couple of swimming tips. You know, both of my kids went through the YMCA swim program because I didn't want them to sink like a rock, and I wanted them to at least be able to get to safety, if not enjoy swimming, would be great. So here's some tips. And this is not rocket science. You could do this too. You could come up with this too. First thing, I've kind of said it, but let me say it again. Swimming has to be constant. You have to keep staying at it. You have to keep in motion. If you're in the water, you can't just take breaks. You stop, you sink. You got to be moving. You got to keep swimming because you're never done. You're never really done if you're living. There's no point where you stop, because if you stop, you die. Leonardo da Vinci, genius, right? Wonderful artist. We go to museums to see his work. But I want to tell you something I read in a biography about him. It was fascinating. Was da Vinci spent his life never believing that one single project he worked on was done. Not till he was dead. What do I mean? They have a hard time. They'll take some of his paintings and they try to date them, and they can't because he would paint it, and then as he learned a new style and technique, he'd go back and redo it. And they were done throughout his whole lifetime. His project, St. Jerome, he worked on for 20 years over and over, redoing. He would never give away his adoration of the Magi. And when he died, all around his deathbed were masterpieces that he just never felt were done, because you could always learn something new, to improve, to grow, and always make it better. That would be a great philosophy for life. Because in the moving and in the activity, you are growing, shaping, improving, learning, even when you make mistakes, even when you sin. Because if you sit still, you'll die. We will never grow into who we're to be. We can only become by doing. So in doing that constant and ongoing process, you will improve, repair, and restore. That's my first thing. Always stay with it. Second, no solo swimming. I was always taught that. I was also taught, not one of my rules, but I think my parents made it up. We'd go to the beach, and we'd going to go swimming, and we would eat, and they would say, oh, you can't swim for so many minutes. And that would, they would go take a nap, and I think that was their way of taking a nap. But one thing they did preach that I know is true is you don't want to go by yourself. You want a lifeguard or a swimming partner, because if you go by yourself, get a leg cramp, you're gone. So it's dangerous. Well, in life, you don't want to do life alone. That is the beauty of the church. It's why you need a community. It's why we need your help until we get a youth director to work with our youth, because we've all, many of us, have benefited from the beauty of a youth group and the encouragement and the growth of a group. And that's why we need a children's ministry. It's why the women's Bible study and the book studies are important in Sunday school. We need to be in relation with one another. We just need it. We learn and we grow from it. Third, good news. You got to have the right swimming coach, and you've got them. It's not me. It's God. God. Once a young man named Ben was struggling with an important decision. He'd been feeling the call to be a missionary, but he had read about how hard it was. You saw the videos. I mean, that's hard stuff. What if he failed, he asked his dad. He says, what if God calls me to do something that I can't do? And his dad thought about it a moment, and he saw his son's baseball glove on the floor. He picked it up, and he said, what's this? He said, "Don't. That's my baseball glove. You know that, Dad." So his dad took the glove and set it against the wall. Then he walked across the room, and he took the ball, and he threw it into the glove, and of course it rolled out. He said, well, your glove doesn't work. It's a failure. And he smiled and said, Dad, you know, it can't catch by itself. The glove doesn't do well unless my hand is in it. And his dad said this, you're just like the glove. God has a purpose for your life, Ben. You put your hand inside the glove to give it guidance and strength. You give it the power to catch the ball. In the same way, God will give you the power to do whatever God calls you to do. It's God's mighty hand that does the work when you're willing to be used. Friends, it's been an interesting journey to go through Genesis. It's challenging when you read it as an adult. When we're kids, we see it through Sunday school eyes, but as an adult, we see all these things that are different. But I pray that these lessons we've looked at will not just be a, that's interesting, kind of sermon. I hope we take them to heart. I hope we live them in our lives. Because if we're honest, stories in the Bible often reflect us in so many ways, the best and the worst. But one lesson Isaac and Abraham and Jacob and Joseph and all these people teach us is this: we are not done yet. Because God is not done with anybody in this room. Life is still here, and whether you're 9 or 99, work is to be done because God has given you the gift of life. Personal struggles, family drama, sins and mistakes, line up, we all got them. And that's why the church is needed in this moment. You're here, the work is here. Whatever's going on around this church, we the church are needed in Amherst County. Whatever the war in Europe results in, whatever the virus decides to do, whatever the price of gas across the street is going to do 5 times tomorrow, none of that stops God's church. None of it. It simply just means we're needed more, aren't we? Your friends, your neighbors, they're struggling, they're you know, they need desperately the love that we are so thankful for. So I say swim. Swim with all you have. Swim together. But thankfully, swim with God. But swim. Let's pray. Gracious God, we come to you today, and the truth of the matter is, we want to look at the messes of the Bible and say, boy, what a mess. But then we look in the mirror and we say, whoa, I've got some work to do too. And that's where it starts, is looking at the authentic reality of our situation and then deciding to make steps that will make life better and make us more into your image. So I pray that we'll do that, that we'll jump in the water, that we'll head forward, and that we'll have some faith while we do it. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Spirit, we pray. Amen. Our hymn is Jesus Calls Us Over the Tumult. I will be at the front. If there's anything I can greet you with, let us stand as we sing. As we leave this place, if I was going to give you homework again, I would say this. If you are in life and you are struggling right now and you want to be determined, I pray that this week you'll look for a friend, take the step of faith, turn to one of your friends. Just, you don't have to tell them your whole story, but just say, I'm just needing some prayer and encouragement. Trust somebody so you don't have to do it alone. And if you get that kind of call, be there for one another. Maybe there's someone you know already that's struggling. Reach out to them this week. We're in this together. We'll close in prayer. Personnel, if you'll meet me in just a few minutes in the conference room, I promise we won't stay long. Just want to cover some bases. But I thank you for all you are and all you're doing. Don't forget next week as we have a special Sunday plan for lunch with Cadence. So let us close in prayer. Gracious God, as we leave this place to the places you will take us, we do not go alone. We have you and we have one another. May we go with faith. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Spirit, we pray. Amen and amen. Thank you.